Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're so glad to welcome you as part of our community tonight. Please note that this webinar is being recorded and distributed live stream. By entering this virtual meeting room, you give your consent to be recorded and distributed by Simeon Morrow Public Speaking Presentations, Vienna Live with Simeon Morrow, and other third parties. If you prefer to not be recorded, please turn off your microphone and camera and or go to the Facebook Live video feed, the link to which I'll now place in the chat room. For a better experience, please turn off your microphone and set your video to gallery view. This show thrives on participant contributions, and all participants are encouraged to actively participate in this webinar by asking questions and making comments. To do so, please either write in the chat room, raise your hand, or turn on your microphone and say hi, and I'll be delighted to include your perspective in the conversation. Tonight, our featured guest is Joe Lovano, a Grammy-winning saxophonist, composer, and producer. His most recent album, Our Daily Bread, is the subject of tonight's show. Joe, welcome.
Hey, thank you. Thanks for inviting me to share some ideas and the music.
So, Joe, tell us a little bit about yourself and how you first became interested in music.
Well, I'm from Cleveland, Ohio, which is where I am right now at a family property. And my dad played saxophone. And I would say he was one of the leading players around Cleveland, jazz musicians in his day. He was born in 1925 and came up through the swing and big band, bebop, modern jazz, freer jazz eras. And he was playing around town all the time as I was growing up. And he was my mentor and teacher, and had an amazing record collection that I thrived on and learned everything from in my early days. He played on the scene in Cleveland during the late 40s after he came back from the service. And into the 50s, Cleveland was really a thriving scene, along with Detroit and Chicago and Pittsburgh and Boston and Philadelphia, Kansas City, New Orleans. There was a lot going on during that era. And musicians, all of the master musicians that we revere in jazz toured and played in all of those towns. And actually, most of the players came from all of those towns. Cleveland had an amazing place in that touring schedule, because it was right between Pittsburgh and Detroit. And all of the groups, and I'm speaking from Coleman Hawkins and Charlie Parker, John Coltrane, Miles Davis, Thelonious Monk, Art Blakey, would play in Cleveland a lot. And my dad was in some bands that played opposite a lot of groups. My mom remembered hearing him when they were engaged in 1950 or so, opening for Stan Getz, for example, at a club called Lindsay Sky Bar, where Billie Holiday played and Charlie Parker played with strings. My dad sat in and played in a lot of jam sessions with Gene Ammons and Coltrane and others in those early days, and had an amazing record collection, like I mentioned, of all the masters that all became my focus and mentors, you know. So as a teenager, by the time I was a teenager, I started playing tenor around 12 years old, I guess. But I had started on alto and had instruments through my adolescent years, and was learning the fundamentals along the way. But there was always a focus on melody and songs and repertoire. And I got really deep into it as a youngster. So by the time I'm like, you know, get my driver's license and 15, 16 years old, I'm starting to go around sitting in with people because I had a confidence and a repertoire of music that I love to play. And growing up around my dad and all of his colleagues around Cleveland, all of the organ players and piano players and drummers, and bass players, taught me everything, you know? So I was really fortunate.
And Joe, now, when I read about you, you know, you come from Italian, Sicilian heritage. And mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you can just give us a little insight into this, because I mean, I was kind of shocked, I guess, to learn, okay, your father, he was a professional musician in Cleveland. I mean, when we think about Sicilian Italian immigrants, we think about them building the subway of New York City, something like this. Tell us, what was that era like when you know, I mean, because now you're obviously a star jazz musician. What was it like then when you had all this live music, and how is that, I mean, so different today? Give us a little bit of insight into that. As you said, your mother going to those jazz clubs to hear him play, and what that was like growing up.
Well, you know, all four of my grandparents came from Sicily. The Lovano Faraci families on my dad's side came from Alcata le Fuse. And my mom's family, Verzi Serenidi families, came from Cesaro, both province Messina, up in the mountains at the edge of the wilderness, looking up at Mount Etna. They came to the States 1906, 1912, 13, those years, and brought all kinds of music with them and their culture. My grandmothers sang, and my grandmother, Faraci, my dad's mom, her brother played mandolin. And I remember as a kid being at some crazy parties with just nothing but music, you know. Both of my grandfathers passed before I was born, so I didn't really know them. But since I've been touring internationally and doing things on the jazz scene, I've been all over the world, but a lot in Italy and in Sicily. And actually, there's a film that's going to be released, a documentary on my life and music and jazz and the States in general. Franco Maresco is a filmmaker from Palermo. It's in post-production right now, but I'm just starting to get word that it's going to be premiered maybe at the Locarno Festival in Switzerland, a film festival, maybe this summer, later this summer in August.
Congratulations. So
thank you. I'm real excited about it because they filmed me starting in 2017. I played in Palermo with a quartet for a big concert produced by Mr. Maresco about John Coltrane. It was Coltrane's 50th year anniversary of his passing, 2017. So we did a concert of his repertoire. And that was the beginning of the filming, actually. And it's led to going to the two villages, them coming to New York, filming my Trio Tapestry at the Village Vanguard, and coming to my home in New York also. And so there's gonna be a collage of some wild moments. I'm anxious to see how it's all coming together, you know. So you know, I had a chance to just grow up around a lot of music and the joyous feeling and spirit of music. My dad's, he had some brothers, they all played My uncle Nick was 10 years older than my dad. He played tenor saxophone. He was the first one. And I think my grandfather, coming from El Cadi Le Fuse, which is a major center for the arts and music, brought, you know, that with him. There's a bandista, a band formed in 1900 or so, that's still going on today in that village, that play all the parades and funerals and marches down the, you know, during the feast. in both of those villages, my mom's village too, there's a lot of music.
Fantastic.
And those roots came with them, you know, and that joyous thing. My uncle Nick played tenor. He was in a territorial big band that he was in the saxophone section that Dean Martin, the famous singer, he was from Steubenville, Ohio. He was discovered during the time my uncle Nick was in the saxophone section, whenever that was, in the 30s. 40s, whatever. I think the third could have been the late 30s. I'm not sure. And then my uncle Joe played tenor, younger brother of my dad. He was a real a beautiful musician that loved to play. You know, he wasn't a star soloist like my dad. My dad was a soloist. My dad came up under Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie and that songbook, you know. My uncle Carl, my dad's younger brother, he played trumpet. So him and my dad had groups. When I was growing up, I was hearing them play Dizzy's Atmosphere and all kinds of tunes from Dizzy Gillespie, you know? So that was giving me a lot to reach for, to try to execute on my horn, you know? My youngest brother today, my brother Anthony, I would say he's 10 years younger than me. He's one of the leading drummers around Cleveland right now, man. And he grew up playing with my dad and learned how to play all kinds of beats and different ways to play. My dad was into playing for people. His whole thing was he played for people, man. And that was instilled in me as a youngster. And it's still with me today to play with inspired players and try to translate that to your audience.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Joe, let's take a look now exactly at that, at your trio. So here you are. here is your trio. This is Trio Tapestry. And there is Marilyn Crispell, the pianist, and Carmen Castaldi, the percussionist. And of course, you're surrounded by all of these percussion instruments that we don't really associate with jazz. We associate with I don't know, something else. So let's now take a listen to the album. Let's take a listen first to Our Daily Bread. This is the song, Our Daily Bread. Let's have a listen.
Okay. Thank you.
Lovely. So let's take a look here at the liner notes to this. So here is the new album. Here are the liner notes to it. So I want to just read, because I want to show these liner notes, because I think they're so sparse that they tell a story here. So here is there are the songs on the left-hand side. And then we have kind of the text here, the preface, if you will, to a text that is simply the music. There's no other text to be read besides this in these album notes. And I'll read it. It says, in our third Trio Tapestry recording, we explore the power of three and take this opportunity to create within all 12 grace notes. Inspired by Charlie Hayden and the spirituality in improvisation, we look deep into a crystal ball of reflections. Our daily bread is fueled by the rhythm spirit of expression that projects the mysterious world of music that lies ahead. So, I mean, very mysterious, very cryptic. And so, Joe, now tell us a little bit about creating this album and working together with Marilyn, with Carmen. Tell us about that. That was just a lovely song, Our Daily Bread, we just heard.
Well, thank you. And one thing, I wrote that text just using all the titles of the tunes. If you go through the text, it refers to each piece as put together for this particular presentation of music, you know. To do a recording is very important for me, to document the moment of now in reflection of where you've been as a musician and in your life, projecting where you can go, or the mysterious world of where you could go, as far as how you feel. To play with feeling and expression is what it's all about, you know, for me. And composing for this particular session with this group, it was a magical thing. We've been together playing, I guess we really first formed in this trio somewhere around 2018 or so. And this is our third release, like I mentioned in that text. The first was Trio Tapestry, recorded in New York City. And that photograph you saw with the gongs is a collection of gongs that I have from my travels around the world. And that's just a small part of it, you know. On the international scene for me, since I was with the Woody Herman Band in the late 70s, I guess 1977 was my first tours to Europe with Woody. And I started to collect instruments everywhere, you know, percussion instruments and woodwind instruments in particular, but some stringed instruments also. And today I have quite a collection of beautiful instruments that I try to explore and experience the vibrations of tonalities. You know, whether it's a stringed instrument from China or woodwind instruments from the Middle East. You know, these particular gongs were all from Wuhan, China. And some are from Pasty, also in Switzerland, Pasty cymbals that make some beautiful gongs. And some are handmade gongs made by some folks that I've met through the years on my tours, you know. To strike a gong, you have a tonality and you have a rhythm in how you approach playing on the gong. So through the years, I've developed a way of playing the saxophone and gongs at the same time, holding a mallet in my right hand and playing the saxophone and striking certain pitches and tonalities on the gongs in a certain rhythmic way, and improvising on the tenor saxophone within those sounds and rhythms. Of course, that turns around also. So I'm striking the gongs inside the rhythm that I'm playing on saxophone. It goes both directions, you know? And there's a solo piece on the first Trio Tapestry record called One Time In that I play a solo saxophone gong piece, you know? But on this new recording, Our Daily Bread, there's gongs within as well in some of the music, you know? When you live in the world of music, you know, what is jazz? You know, jazz is an idea about how to play and how to be creative with the fundamentals of music and who you are, where you've been. The more songs you know in your life and love to play and execute harmonically, melodically, rhythmically, that all comes out in your improvisations as you explore whatever piece of music it is, you know? And for me, that's that idea has been developing my whole life, and it's starting to really crystallize now. And recording for ECM Records has really been giving me a chance to dig deeper into who I am and my particular story, you know? Our second recording, Garden of Expression, also, you could, if you heard all three of these dates in a sequence, you would feel the development in how we play together. The more you play together, the more you say something inside the music.
And let's now go into this improvisation and what as we will talk about, called spirituality of improvisation. So actually I want to first have us listen to another song, and this song is called One for Charlie. Here we go. Okay, mysterious. So let's now I'd like to show people a little bit about where this concept of spirituality in music is kind of was taking flight for you. So there is a school called the Cal Arts Herbert Alpert School of Music, and there is a jazz program there. And there, I'm going to read this. There's a course that you taught called The Spirituality of Improv. And the description is here, quote, "The Spirituality of Improvisation, Charlie Hayden, Cal Arts Artist in Residence, with special guest Joe Lovano. The series features very special guest artists who worked closely with Charlie Hayden, the founder of Cal Arts Jazz Program and faculty at Cal Arts for over 30 years. Each guest is invited to send music to our students and faculty, focusing on their own compositions, as well as Charlie's compositions and important music from other sources. Our students and faculty learn this music and have the chance to get to know the guest artist over the 1 week residency. Every year, this event has been an exceptionally memorable highlight of the Cal Arts experience for all of the participants and is a significant part of the jazz program and music school's curricular offerings and visiting artist series. We still use the course title, The Spirituality of Improvisation, which was the name of Charlie's class for many years. The process of improvisation is applicable to all schools at Cal Arts, and students from across the institute have enrolled in the past. It is not necessary to be a musical performer to benefit from the invaluable and universal principles of improvisation." So tell us a little bit, Joe, about Charlie Hayden, about this course, The Spirituality of Improvisation. So everything that you've said to this moment is about music having some sort of other significance. I mean, the in ancient times, music was part of astronomy. The ancients believed in the West that music was some kind of attached to the stars. It had something to do with, you know, this the harmony of the world. So everything you've said so far, it seems like your music is really spirituality and music go hand in hand. Tell us about teaching this course, about your relationship with Charlie Hayden, and how that is reflected in this new album, Our Daily Bread.
Wow. Okay. Well, thanks for that question. And, you know, it's like a way of life. It's how you feel about your relationships with people, humanity, and coexistence on this planet. And Charlie was a very spiritual, amazing human man. He was such a deep musician. If everybody knows about Charlie Hayden's music and his history, he was feeling this from hearing Charlie Parker play. And everything that he encountered as a young musician coming up, getting together with Ornette Coleman in the 50s, and what led him even to that moment, he was feeling this, the spirit of the music. When you listen to the masters on recordings, whether it's Coleman Hawkins and Ben Webster and Lester Young, Billie Holiday, Charlie Parker, you know, Miles, Coltrane, you feel an inner spirit being revealed in their music, in their sound, in their feeling. You know, for me, that study is continuing today because it's like a way of life, really. And it's how you are with people in your family, your relationships. It comes from your deepest sources of inspiration as a person. And through the years, I've had a chance to really play with some of the master musicians that I grew up listening to. You know, as a young player, you're in the audience, whether you put on a recording or you go hear people live. You know, I was so fortunate to stand toe to toe with my dad and his sound and his feeling about how he played a melody. You know, in my earliest lessons, learning scales and arpeggiating through harmonies in all 12, which is one of the titles of my tunes on this recording, all 12, in all 12 keys, all 12 tones, and how each tone represents all 12 of the other tones, and how you hear it and feel it, how you could turn that one tone into a sound within the other tones, intervals. Anyway, that study led to some of these compositions for this record, you know, from my experiences playing with Charlie Hayden, joining the Palm Motion Trio and Quintet in 1981, and playing with Paul till his passing in 2011, for 30 years with Bill Frisell and I, touring the world and recording, documenting so many things. And each piece of music that we ever played together had a spiritual feeling to it. It wasn't technical about repeating a rehearsal. We would learn the piece of music, internalize it, and explore it in a free-flowing manner. And that is the whole foundation of my Trio Tapestry also, you know, with piano and drums and percussion and saxophone, to play as an ensemble with an idea of an orchestra. We're covering a lot of music within each piece, you know, to create music within the music. You know, I learned that from playing with Charlie. From the mid 80s, I started to play with Charlie, and I joined the Liberation Music Orchestra 1986. And I found myself in an amazing band with Don Cherry on trumpet and Dewey Redman on tenor saxophone, Paul Motion on drums, Mick Goodrick on guitar, Jerry Allen, or Amina Claudine Myers, or Carla Bley on piano, Ken McIntyre on alto saxophone, who recorded with Eric Dolphy, and he had like a whole system and concept about who he was and how he felt music. Tom Harrell was also on trumpet in the Liberation Music Orchestra, and Ray Anderson on trombone, you know, players that really played with a deep sense of who they were inside the music. And that whole free-flowing idea about creating music within the music has always been with me. And I found myself in some amazing bands through the years, you know.
Joe, and maybe can you also, now going back to what we talked about, your father playing in these swing bands, you know, your grandfather discovering Dean Martin and all that, I think we can agree that was a completely different kind of music. That was, you know, none of those people were, you know, performing with the thought in mind that they were performing, you know, their, you know, themselves inside the music. I imagine they would say they're trying to be together, they're trying to put on a good show.
But you know what? The one thing that makes it one is that they love to play. And they projected that. No matter what style or era you're in, the moment of now is always with us. And if you play with a sense of passion and love, then you're dealing with what I'm trying to speak on. It's all about love. And it's all about also, you know, the awareness of what you're doing and who you're doing it with and how you're doing. My mom would always tell me from a teenager when I'd be going to play a wedding or whatever, play pretty for the people, Joey. That, man, that reverberates for me all the time when I think of my mom. My mom and my Aunt Rose, they were the ones that heard me practice down the basement. They were the ones, and they knew all of the songs I was trying to learn. from their generation growing up in the American songbook, right? Standard songs, they call them standard songs. I call them famous music, you know, music that everybody plays. And to learn how to play your instrument, you have to deal with that repertoire. Young cats today that do not deal with the music. When I say the music, I mean the music. The beautiful beauty in melodies and in harmonic sequences that the American songbook brought into jazz, you know. Jazz is a folk music also, New Orleans and from Africa and the rhythms and all the things. It was a multicultural experience to play jazz. And to be expressive in the world of music, jazz is a part of it. You know, it's the deep feeling of swinging and expression. But the one common thing from all of that, when you listen to Dean Martin or Frank Sinatra, or Sammy Davis Jr., or Billy Eckstein, Sarah Vaughan, some singers, Mel Torme. What are you hearing? You're hearing a passion and a love that comes through in their tone, in their sound, in their presentation, how they feel through a song, you know? Then you could listen to John Coltrane, and you could listen to Sonny Rollins, and you could listen to others that take that simple little song, simple little theme, and turn it into a symphony of ideas from their travels and experiences, you know? The whole idea of practicing and playing and working things out. The one record that John Coltrane's record, Chasing the Train, for example, it's a blues. It's a whole side of an LP, 20 minutes, with a simple improvised melody that he created at that moment in that certain key that he takes and explores. And, oh, man, it's like, it's a deep study about being yourself and dealing with where you're coming from on your horn, you know? It's not about practicing and repeating licks and all that. It's about taking two notes and one note and turn it into something. Do something with that note. That's my dad always told me, man, from listening, and he got it from Lester Young and Illinois Jacquet and players that did something with every note. In their sound, in their dynamics. This piece we just listened to, one for Charlie, to get back to that, that's three times through the composition, okay? But each time I never exactly play note for note the way I wrote it. The sequence of tones are there, and each tone suggests certain harmonies and certain things for me. But I just played three choruses of an interpretation of a melody. And that's exactly what you do when you improvise on a song. You listen to Miles Davis play Round Midnight, for example, Thelonious's masterpiece. He never plays it note for note, how Monk wrote it. He takes those sequences of tones and plays them with his own feeling, and tells his own story inside the story of the tune. That's where I'm at as an improviser these days.
Joe, let's have a listen one more time. Let's listen to it again. So here it is, one for Charlie. Listening to it again, here is Joe playing it three times through.
Yeah. Thank you. That's one time. That's one. Start a second. Second, this is the second chord.
Fantastic. So I want us, I would just say again, it seems like your today, what we're showing is something that really follows the classical music trajectory of very, you know, before you had these very, very large symphonies, 1890 with Mahler and 1900, and everything started moving to become very, very small. So then you'd even have, you know, like a micro music, 30 seconds or, you know, just a few notes. And it seems like that's what we're listening to, the way that you're breathing, the very, very small overtones that you play. I mean, it's not, as you said, one tone, you know, it's, you can't speak of a middle C or middle D. I mean, there are so many notes in and around there that it's just kind of a universe. Is that correct? Is that fair to say, Joe?
Yeah, you know, in a way, jazz developed from larger ensembles, from the Louis Armstrong, certain bands he had, the Ellington Band, a lot of the big band era. There were so many bands with all kinds of five saxophones. And when Ben Webster joined Duke Ellington in 1940, that was the first time it was five saxophones in a sax section, for example. And things started to pare down, got into the more of the bebop school, and then more quintets and trios and quartets, and you know, the combination of folks is always a celebration, no matter what size of the group, just like in classical music, you know. The idea of taking one tone, and let's say you take a C, and okay, it's a C, but now if you're playing in the key of F, what does that C? That C has a different tonal, different sound when you're in the key of F. If you're in the key of G flat, that same C has a different sound, right? If you're in the key of A flat, it has a different sound, you know? So when you go through all 12, on all 12, you're playing in like all kinds of keys and sounds, combinations of ideas, you know what I mean? Like a classical composer would, as the writer, as the composer, Mozart or whoever, Beethoven, Stockhausen, Bartok, they would take tones and turn them into all kinds of sounds. As an improviser, you do that spontaneously if you're really in it. And it's not just a chromatic scale. You're in all 12 all the time. You listen to Coltrane and McCoy Tyner, I started to play with McCoy Tyner in 1991 and played with him really until he passed, I think, in 2020. Our last gig was 2018 or 17. He was honored at the Library of Congress. I played with him there, the quartet. But anyway, to play with McCoy Tyner, no matter what tune you were in, and his some of his pieces are some really like strong, beautiful chants. You know, they're a chant with melodies that repeat and flowing undercurrent rhythms. But harmonically, man, you're in all 12 when you really get in there. That's why he was Coltrane's number one pianist. You know, him and Alice Coltrane, and that from the 60s on, you know.
Joe, and maybe can we let's listen now? I want to go back to the gong and the percussion in your music, which seems to me to be very, you're kind of one of your signature things. So I want us to listen to an album. This is the first album that you released in the 1980s. Let's listen and tell me if you hear any gongs. Okay, and now I want us to listen to another album of yours from the 2000, excuse me. Let's listen to that. Hear if there's any percussion. Fantastic. And now I'd like to listen one more time to why are you laughing, Joe?
Well, this particular song, it was one of the first Italian songs I ever wrote. I played it for my mom when I wrote it over the phone, and it was like remembering that moment.
Fantastic. It's a family story. So let's listen now again to come back to your newest album. Let's listen. Let me find it. So this is then where we are today. So we've listened to 1985, I believe it was, and then 2000. And then here is the song called Grace Notes. Let's listen to this and see if we can hear the connection.
Okay.
Okay. So, Joe, I just want to ask you, so coming back to this spirituality and improvisation class, so we hear, you know, this is from, of the three recordings that we previously heard, this is extremely abstract. I mean, and tell us now again, what should people listen to? What should people be listening for? What do you hope that they take away from this album?
Well, that we are playing as one and trying to create music out of thin air. This last piece is an example of that. Okay, the gongs, we had a beautiful set of gongs and temple bells. And I was playing the gongs and temple bells, and Carmen was also. So between the two of us, we were creating an atmosphere as if you were sitting in a cathedral, in a silent cathedral, and hearing church bells with a lot of space and distance in between each attack. And then the idea of this piece, Grace Notes, to play notes nobody wrote, but the idea to play over a drone. We're playing over kind of a D pedal drone. So when Marilyn enters, she enters with this sound of a drone, a meditation. It's coming from a meditation, this particular piece. And I titled it Grace Notes with that idea in mind. Notes from God that nobody wrote, that we're creating as we move along. And I'm playing this Hungarian folk instrument. It's called a terragato, which is a woodwind instrument that comes apart like a clarinet. It's made of rosewood. And the left hand is fingered like a saxophone fingering. The right hand is Albert System clarinet. And it's the gypsies played. This instrument is in the folk music in Romania and Hungary, and the music that Bartok grew up on, he was hearing these sounds and these things, you know. Anyway, my particular instrument I acquired when I was in Budapest in 2003 on a tour with the Saxophone Summit with Michael Brecker and Dave Liebman. And Billy Hart was there, and Cecil McBee, and Phil Markowitz on piano. And we were on a tour, and we played in Istanbul, and we played in Budapest. And I acquired a bunch of instruments on that tour. So did Mike and Dave too. But the terragato was there, and I ended up getting this particular horn then. So it's been a good 20 years that I've been playing on that instrument, and it made in the late 30s. Beautiful horn. And has a real earthy quality to it. There's a lot of air in the sound. There's open holes like a clarinet, right? anyway, the idea of that particular piece, each piece on this recording, I think you could listen to and feel in a different way. You know, we recorded also in a beautiful recital hall in Lugano, Switzerland, a room that Manfred really loves to record. And we set up on stage with no audience, but it was a beautiful sounding room that had this recital hall cathedral sound in it. So by playing with no headphones and just setting up and playing together as a trio, the takes that we made were influenced by where we were playing and how we were recording, you know. And Manfred wasn't up in the booth with the engineer and all. He was sitting in the seats listening to us, like he was our audience for some of these takes, you know. And I'm pretty sure this one he was sitting out there, and the music just unfolds in a real magical way. And also in the sequence of how we played this particular date, Our Daily Bread, we created the mood of the piece we were in from the mood we were in previously. So if we played a concert and had the tunes in a different order, there would be some different takes. They would have a different energy, different atmosphere is what happened in a live performance for an audience in the sequencing of things, you know? Manfred is a master at sequencing and post-production. And that's where he really shines, man, on all of his productions. He's very involved in that whole process.
Okay.
I really appreciate that from him, man. He's a genius in that way of studying the music after it's already laid down and feeling how it could come together. Now, the very first piece you played, 1985, my piece, Tones, Shapes, and Colors, I had a score that I was following with certain moments of saxophone and spaces for me to attack a gong, a certain key, a certain pitch in the gong to go with where I was, what I was hearing on the saxophone. 1977, my first tour to Europe with Woody Herman. We played in London. I went to his amazing Oriental music store, Rayman's Music. And I bought a handful of gongs, okay? So after the tour in New York, I have a loft in New York where I could play with drummers till midnight that I lived. So anyway, I had these gongs all hanging. And one day I was practicing, just playing myself, solo saxophone. And certain pitches that I hit, all of a sudden the gongs started to sing without me even touching them, just from the vibrations of my sound and the tone. So one day I grabbed a mallet in my right hand and I kept playing, because you could play the saxophone with, you can play a lot of the saxophone with your left hand, with octave keys and different things. You could play a lot of the saxophone, which I learned watching and seeing Rahsaan Roland Kirk when I was a kid. When I was a teenager, I heard Rahsaan came to Cleveland and he played 2-3 saxophones at once and fingered the tenor with one hand and played the whole saxophone with one hand. And then he would use his other hand to play tonalities on other horns, you know. Anyway, from Rahsaan's influence, that just kind of was a study for me growing up. So anyway, I started to attack a few pitches with the gongs and play some rhythm in between. And from 1977 on, I started to develop an approach about playing the gongs and percussion and the saxophone at the same time. And 1985 was the first document of that. And it's been carrying on now through the years. Fantastic. Something that's still happening today. Yeah.
Fantastic. Joe, so let's see how we can get the album. Here it is. It's on ECM Records, and you can buy it for €17.90 on CD or LP. And I believe you can also buy it. Here are the other recordings of the Trio Tapestry. And I believe you can, so you can listen to it. In any case, it's available there. And I will put this in the chat room. And then let's see how we can stay in touch with Joe. So here is his website, joelovano.com. And can people reach out to you here, Joe?
Yes, for sure. Definitely. Perfect. I love to hear from some folks.
Excellent. So reach out to Joe with your questions and comments. That is joelovano.com. Here it is. I'll put that in the website, in the chat room. Thank you so very much to Joe Lovano.
Hey, wow. Thank you, Simeon, for asking me to participate in the series you're doing. It's so great, man. Thank you very, very much.
So let's take a look at next week. We have coming up, it is Ana Maria Mendieta, Tango del Cielo. The pedal harp is arguably classical music's most sumptuous instrument. Indeed, the harp's ornate column majestically towers over the symphony orchestra as if to conspicuously draw attention to its founding role in Western music. But when it comes to the harp's musical language, most of us can only imagine it intoning a calm celestial world, a peaceful ether where the passionate utterances of daily life have no bearing. Harpist Ana Maria Mendieta, one of the instrument's foremost ambassadors, will show us how down-to-earth this versatile instrument can really be. Her most recent performance takes audiences on a theatrical musical journey to July 9th Avenue in Buenos Aires, where she leads a full orchestra and sets the stage for a sensual grand tango. Not surprisingly, Tango del Cielo, as it's called, has been awarded 4 Global Music Awards and debuted at number 2 on Billboard's classical crossover chart. Come welcome Ana Maria to our show. As always, all information about upcoming shows may be found at www.simeonmore.com. Once again, thank you so very much to Joe Lovano. Thank you to Agnieszka and Benoit Rivolet, and to Victoria and Frederick Mulligan for their support of this show. Most of all, thanks to you, our participants, who make it all worthwhile from New London, New Hampshire, and Cleveland, Ohio. Goodbye, and see you next Wednesday.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you all. Yes.